Well, good evening, and welcome to Happy New Year, and welcome to another episode of Corner Conversations. Didn't think I was going to get it right, did you?
I wasn't sure, but you did.
Frankly, I wasn't sure either. But I'm Paul W. Marino, and my compadre here is Roger Urban, and Roger is going to be starting with another wonderful book.
Well, wonderful is an interesting statement from you. This is a book that's near and dear to my heart. It's called Another Day, Another Great Day at Sea. It's written by Jeff Dyer, and it's about his life aboard the USS George H.W. Bush, which is an aircraft carrier, one of the newer ones. I was partial to this book because I served on a rather large aircraft carrier at the time. Matter of fact, at the time it was one of the largest, which was the USS Saratoga. The new ones are even bigger and longer and heavier and carry more stuff. But
like planes and like helicopters.
Planes and bombs and all
and
kinds
soldiers.
Of stuff.
Oh my.
And no soldiers. No. We had Marines.
Oh.
But no soldiers. Anyhow, to get into the book, it's about a journalist who's wanted to go aboard an aircraft carrier to see what life on board this type of ship would be like. And it brought home some great memories for me. Give me a second or two and I will get into it. He flew out to the ship, the aircraft carrier, on what was known as a COD, C-O-D, Carrier Onboard Delivery is what it stands for. And of course, when you get into your first flight in a Navy aircraft, you get a briefing, and then they check you to make sure you've got everything you're supposed to have and nothing that you're not supposed to have. And then they talk about what's gonna happen. So he had to hand over his computer bag. He didn't like to do that. He said he's never done it before, but they made him do it, for obvious reasons, which we'll get into. He said it had to be stowed away because when we landed on the carrier and the plane touched down and hooked the arresting wire, and we'll get into that, we would go from 140 miles an hour to zero in a couple of seconds. Now that's an amazing deceleration if you
yes.
think about it. It's called the trap. When you hit the wire and it catches and the aircraft comes to a halt, you've been trapped. It was a good trap. But think about it, going from 130 or 140 in this case to zero. Now the jets come in even faster. There are four wires that are stretched across the deck and the stern, and the aircraft has a hook that it drops.
Mm-hmm.
And the object is to have that hook catch the number three wire. Number three wire is a perfect landing. Now, every time you make a landing, the pilot makes a landing on an aircraft carrier, he's graded as to what kind of landing it was. Was it good? Was it bad? Whatever. So it's important to them. The best landing is to catch the number three wire, and that's a perfect landing. And of course, you have to be level. If you have one wing lower than the other, it doesn't last long. So anyhow, he said the interesting thing for him was also getting dressed to get into the aircraft. He had to wear a cranial. Now, for those of you who don't know what a cranial is, and I suppose that means probably most of you, but you can judge it means something, some type of headgear. It's protective headgear that they wear. The pilots and air crew have a different type of headgear. It looks like a football helmet, but it's pretty elaborate. But the cranials are smaller in nature and don't give you the complete protection that the pilots have. In other words, it keeps you from getting a concussion or whatever have you when something hits your head. Also, they have to wear a life jacket, okay? And we'll get into that after.
I think that's a pretty obvious thing.
Yeah, but it's lightweight. You don't even realize that that's what it is, but they call them float coats.
Mm-hmm.
So if you go overboard and you happen to get into the water, if you're lucky enough to make it into the water off the aircraft, then that thing will inflate and it will float and they can pick you up, hopefully. So he's talking about the aircraft that he was coming in on, and it was called a Greyhound, COD, carrier onboard delivery. Well, now what that means is they can deliver small parts and things of that sort that they need, mm-hmm. Any type of food supply that might be necessary to bring in, and personnel, and carry up to 8 passengers. He didn't like the plane. He thought it was kind of cheap looking, but it's a good aircraft. Anyhow, he mentions a takeoff. Now, this is he was taking off from land, and the thing that made him a little disconcerting, or was disconcerting to him, was the amount of noise that this aircraft generates. Well, it was a propeller-driven aircraft, but it didn't have the normal combustion engines, okay? It was more powerful than that. And
so if it's not an internal combustion engine, what is it?
It's a turbofan. In other words, it's a turbine, but instead of blasting hot air out the stern of the aircraft,
mm-hmm.
it turns a propeller. In this case, 2 propellers. There's 2 engines.
So anyhow, how is it powered?
By aircraft fuel, JP5 or whatever
mm-hmm.
propulsion. I don't know what it carries as far as fuel, but it's the normal fuel for a piston engine aircraft of that type. And that's carried normally in the wings.
Yeah. Yeah, I knew that.
His description, and I'll read just a portion of it. They were briefed about what was going on, and he was strapped tight, struck by the undisguised use of the rivet in the seat in front of me. Everything in the plane was ripped, scuffed, stretched, stripped. Tubes and pipes and cables and superstructure were all laid bare. Commercial planes from the world's poorest airlines outdid this one when it came to frills. So even to imagine this plane to anything in the fleets of the largest aircraft of the West and airlines of the West would give a distorted impression of luxury. It's not made for luxury. It's made for work. Anyhow, they taxied out, and the plane accelerated and took off and landed. He said, after 40 minutes, the bumpy ride became jumpier still as we descended, bucking the Bronco air. There was a stomach-graining church and heave. We weren't. The flight attendant's arm came up in a sparring lasso gesture, like so, indicating we missed the arresting wire and we're bolting. Now, a bolter is something the pilots don't want to hear. That means the hook was down and they missed all the wires that are stretched across in the back. Now, when I say wires, these cables are about 2.5-3 inches in diameter. They're huge, very flexible though. So anyhow, they circled around and came, descended again, and this time we thumped down and came to a dead stop instantly. It was sudden, but not as violent as I expected or feared, possibly because we were facing backwards, so we were forced into our seats rather than being thrown forward and out of them, which is normal for a naval aircraft for passengers to be seated towards the back of the aircraft, and mm-hmm. not facing forward. And the reason for it is if they do make a carrier landing, it's much less stressful on the passengers. The pilots, of course, are looking out the windscreens. He talks about the size of the ship and the American flag and the rotating radars are up on the island. Now, the island is the part that you see off the flight deck. You see a very flat yeah. flight deck, and then you see this thing rising up. It's called an island. This contains the bridge which is used to direct the ship, to drive the ship. It contains the, pardon me, some of the electronics installations that have to be used, not only to control the aircraft, because it is an airport, sort of, but also to help drive the ship. So you can imagine how cluttered the whole interior of that island is. And also, that's where the captain is, and an admiral if he's on board. When he got out of the aircraft, he was amazed because there was a whole bunch of people running around the flight deck doing various and sundry things, and they all had different colored jerseys on. And they had the cranials, but the cranials were color-coded to match their jerseys and their float coats. He mentioned the jets and everything that was parked there. He said, it was amazing. He said, one moment we're traveling 140 miles an hour, and the next we had stopped, the hatch opened, and we entered another world with black visored people looking one way or the other and scurrying around. Three in white jerseys and float coats stepped up to the ramp and told us to follow in single file. Now, the white jerseys indicated that they were personnel directors. If a plane was coming in and carried passengers, they told them how to get out of the way of anything else that might kill them and get down into the bowels of the ship.
On a boat like that is practically everything.
Yeah, but you never call it a boat. Ooh. It's a ship.
Yeah.
Yes. It's a flight deck on an aircraft carrier is a very dangerous place for a number of reasons. You have propellers that are spinning. You have rotors on helicopters that are spinning. You have the jet blast, if any jets are in the area. Mm-hmm. And also the intake of a jet is a dangerous thing. And these are very powerful aircraft, the jets are. Anyhow, 3 more cranial covered guys with brown jerseys went out to the aircraft, and they were carrying these chains. And you wonder what the chains were for. Well, they're to tie down the airplane. In the deck of the ship, there's a hole about that big around, and there's a cross piece of steel, and they have a hook that would hook into that and keep the aircraft from going one way or the other. Mm-hmm. And there's several of them, so they can tie the aircraft down and it's safe. So he's getting to learn a little bit more about why the different colored jerseys. Well, the jerseys are white for people that personnel directors, so to speak. Yellow, which are the fellows that guide the aircraft when it's on board the ship, on the deck. Also in yellow, and he'll have captain on his back, would be the plane captain. Now, he's not the captain of the ship, but he is captain of that aircraft.
Mm-hmm.
Very important guy. He's the man that tells you whether your plane is safe to get into and fly or not. He's the guy that does a check on your aircraft after or just before you do your pre-flight check. So two people are actually checking a plane before you get into it. And that's to make sure that nothing is amiss with the aircraft. You can do different things. Now, I flew a propeller-driven aircraft, and the pre-flight that we used to do as the pilot was to walk the aircraft, walk around it, make sure nothing was out of place, check the sides and the wings to make sure no rivets or anything had popped, nothing was loose that shouldn't be loose, that the ailerons, and you actually take them and you move them, and make sure that they work properly. You go back to the tail, make sure that's in good shape. You move the elevators, which are on the tail.
And the rudder.
And then the rudder. You check the tail hook, make sure that's in good shape. You don't want to come in without a tail hook. It's not a happy landing in that way. And then you get up on the wing. For a short guy, and I was fairly short for a pilot, it was kind of a stretch to get up onto the wing, but the flaps come down and there's stair footholds into the flaps of the ship. So you're able to get up there. Undo the caps, the gas caps on each wing, make sure that you have fuel. And you make sure the fuel is the right color. Now, aviation fuels for in the Navy are different colors. The jets have one color, the props have another, et cetera, et cetera. So you have to make sure that yours is the proper color for what you have. Then, because it was a piston engine aircraft, that is pistons like you have in your car, we had to walk around the front of the airplane. I had to step on a stool because the plane is parked like so. This aircraft didn't have tricycle landing gear. And reach into the cowling and wipe your hand down to the bottom of the cowling and see what you come up with. You don't want to come up with pieces of metal. You don't want to come up with too much oil. Now, the first time I did it, and I came up with a glove, and the gloves were yellow leather, was completely black. And my instructor came out at the time, and he said, "What's wrong?" And I said, "I'm going to down the aircraft." He said, "Why?" And I said, "Look." He said, "Roger." He said, "If you don't get any oil, that's when you got to worry about with this plane."
Yeah.
it carried quite a bit of oil, and it tended to leak out. They were old aircraft. They were flown in Korea and designed at the end of World War II. They were used in Vietnam. They were pretty extensively used as fighter-bomber routines, strafing and dropping nasty stuff on the enemy. As he got out of the aircraft that he came in on, he was looking around and he sees all these different colored shirts, and he finally figured out that the guys in the white shirts were to help him to get down below. The yellow shirts were the aircraft guys. They could move, tell you where to go and direct the pilot as to where to park the aircraft. And then he saw purple. What the heck is a purple one for? Well, there are fuels. They took care of the fueling. My roommate on the carrier was the purple guy. He was one of the bosses. And I'll tell you an interesting story in a minute or two about him. Then there's red. These are the guys that take care of the armaments, the guns, they take care of the ammunition, the bombs, the rockets, whatever you're carrying. So each one of these guys has a specific job. They're trained very well, obviously, they have to be, and you have to pay attention to them. Now, being humans, they might miss something. So you do a check as well. You do the same check that they do. And that's to make sure that the aircraft is safe to get in and out of. And getting back to my roommate, he was not only the aircraft fuels officer, he was the fuels officer on the ship. I was standing a watch, that is, we were in port, and we were in Athens, Greece. The Piraeus is the anchorage where we were. Kind of famous in a couple of movies. And I was assigned to the officer's quarter deck as officer of the deck. Now, that meant that anybody leaving the ship had to get my permission to leave the ship, which you normally granted, and my permission to come aboard the ship. Well, we had word that Sixth Fleet was coming on board. That is the admiral who was in charge of the Sixth Fleet. That's the fleet in the Mediterranean. And I was to be on the lookout for him. So I'm standing there on the quarter deck, which is about 65 feet in the air. You have to come up a gangway to get into there. And I see this, what we call the barge, approaching, the admiral's barge. And we carried a glass. It's a telescope about that long. And you look out through it, and you can see what's coming. So I checked it out. Yeah, the admiral's flag was flying on the barge, so I knew we had company.
Now, you say a barge. Is that a car or?
No. It's a motor whaleboat.
Oh, I see.
But it's fancy. It's a nice one. I see him coming, and I knew the skipper, our captain, was on board with him. Now, naturally, Sixth Fleet is going to be the first guy that comes up the gangway. Now, that's about 45, 50 feet in the air from the waterline. So he comes in, and he starts up the gangway, and all of a sudden, there's this funny noise, and looked down at him, and he's covered with oil. Covered with oil on his dress whites. Well, the captain came up behind him, and at that time we had a skipper named Captain Tully, Joe Tully, and he is known, it was known as a real terror. He came flying up the gangway. Urban, what the hell is going on? I said, sir, I haven't the foggiest idea. And I said, all of a sudden, that discharge pipe spewed oil. And unfortunately, the Admiral was the target. He said, well, I'm well aware of that. You get the fuels officer up here, and I want to see him immediately. Well, of course, they rushed the Admiral down to his at-sea cabin, gave him a change of uniform so he could look normal.
And I'll bet he had to wash pretty thoroughly
Well. Oh, yeah. And fuel oil for a ship is thick. It's not like the motor oil in a car.
Yeah, it's probably almost solid.
It's pretty close, yeah. You can actually, you know, put a glob of it in your hand, and like it's almost like a jelly. So needless to say, he got reamed out. He got put in hack, which means he couldn't go ashore. He was a little bit upset with the world. They found out what the problem was. Some sailor down below had turned the wrong valve, and this was a discharge pipe that was spewing out fuel oil. And he took care of it. The captain called him in and said, well, you're still going to be in hack for 2 days. Third day, you can go on the beach. And he was kind of happy with that. So when he got a chance to go on the beach, we both went out to Piraeus and downed a few. He downed more than I did. He had reason to. He's a heck of a good guy. But anyhow, that was his job. So that's the job with the guys with those color coats. But the ones that always amazed me was the guys in the red shirts, the armament officers, and armament sailors. They have to be very careful. And you have to be very careful. If you were carrying any kind of external load of weapons, you had to make sure that they were secure. Because when you take off, you go from zero to flying speed in just a couple of seconds. And anything loose would come flying out and possibly go down the deck and hurt somebody or blow up or damage the ship in some mysterious way.
Mm-hmm.
So that was his introduction. Then he describes walking down a corridor, internal in the ship. And he comes to these hatchways, which are like a big oval. And the bottom of the hatchway is 6 to 8 inches above the deck that you're walking on. And if you're in any hurry or not paying attention, it can give you quite a good bruise, because you end up hitting that, thinking you're going through a door.
And then falling down as well.
Sometimes. We call them knee knockers. And you can tell the guys that had to do the running, you know, in general quarters or something like that, because a lot of them carried bruises on their ankles from the knee knockers. Then he described going to the wardroom and having a meal, which was a lot nicer than what he thought it would be. He ate in the officer's mess, which is called the wardroom. The captain on any ship has his meal separate. The executive officer usually dines with the senior officers.
Mm-hmm.
The junior officers have their own little wardroom on a big ship. And then, of course, the sailors have the mess decks. Aptly named.
How messy are they?
Not that messy.
They're
spotless. They keep them very clean, believe me. But if the sailor gets in trouble, you know, from some minor thing, he's often assigned to do duty for the mess on the mess decks. And they didn't like it if they were not assigned there. But the food on an aircraft carrier was relatively good. The only thing that I did not enjoy, and anybody who was on a carrier at that time will tell you, is you had a choice of a liquid to drink at lunch and at dinner, which was water, milk, or Kool-Aid. Well, both the water, well, the milk was reconstituted milk, which, unless you get used to it, is a lousy drink. The water smelled like JP5, the jet fuel.
Mm-hmm.
Why, I don't know, but it did. And the Kool-Aid was even worse. So when we had foreign officers on board, they weren't too enthralled with the drink that we had at the serve them at a mealtime. Food was terrific. Food was always good. When we got back to the States, we made one stop, and we had a captain who said that we were going to have a barbecue. So they broke out these 55-gallon drums that were cut in half, and they made barbecue pits out of them, and they cooked steaks. I've never seen guys eat so much steak in my life. My crew probably ate about three each, and the food was top-notch. One officer each day is assigned to go down to the mess decks and sample the food that the sailors are eating to make sure that it's wholesome, tasty, and well-cooked.
And is not better than what the officers are getting.
It usually isn't, but it's good. I mean, it's, you know, we might have a steak and they'll have a hamburger or something like that. And then once in a while, they'll get a steak. But it's just to make sure that there are no complaints from the mess decks about the food. I mean, that's one of the highlights of their day. Sailors work hard on a ship. They really do. Chief petty officers in the Navy have their own mess, and officers are not allowed to go in there except by invitation. And you rarely get an invitation. Also, enlisted men are not allowed in the officers' mess. And that ranges from anywhere from the chief petty officer on down. On the carrier that I was on, the officers were segregated by their rank. The junior officers, from ensign to Lieutenant JG, had their own little section of the wardroom. And from Lieutenant JG through commander had a different section, which was not any nicer, but it was segregated. When it came evening time, they always showed a movie on the mess decks. If you didn't have a watch or didn't have anything to do work-wise, you went down, you could have a movie. And the junior officers sat on one side of the screen, and the more senior officers sat on the other. So that when you're a lieutenant commander, you could see the screen as it's supposed to be seen. If you're not, you see the back of the screen. And it's sometimes confusing to you, especially when they have script. You know, you've got to read something, it's a little messed up. So it's really a big city when you come right down to it. 2,000 or 3,000 people, depending on what, you know, what size the ship is. They all have different jobs, they all have different duties. It takes a lot of getting used to. Now, there are parts of the ship where you couldn't go into. There were restricted areas. The area that I worked in was a restricted area, and that was in communications and communications intelligence. We could talk to anybody in the world. We could get messages from everywhere in the world. We could pick up local TV broadcasts if we were close enough to the shore, and movies come out on the COD, carry on board delivery. They would bring us our movies, and we'd give them the old ones back. It was a decent life. It really was. It wasn't that bad. You worked a long shift. You had both your primary duties and then collateral duties. It was a busy day. One of the things I had to do was any intercepts that we had of foreign communications that were relevant to us, I had to make sure the captain got them. And then anything that was of a priority nature, we had to run that up to the captain's, wherever he was on the ship. So I had to know where he was at almost at all times. We had, like, you know, if it was a message that somebody had to was ill, or that, you know, we were about to change orders, or things of that sort. They were his eyes only. It was marked on there for commanding officer's eyes only. And the only other person who saw that was me, or the other watch officer that we had. Mm-hmm. I was not allowed to really read the message, but of course you got it in your hand, you glance at it.
Yeah.
And then they had to go into an envelope and brought up to the captain, and he could do what he wanted with it.
Now, I'm going to interrupt you there, because
sure.
I think we're about halfway through the show.
Oh, wow. Usually I don't take
Hey, you give someone our age the chance to talk freely, and if...
This is an unusual experience.
Well, it's interesting, but I want to remind our viewers, yes, you, both of you, that if you have comments or criticisms or something you'd like to see us talk about, please send us an email at historyman@copper.net. Nicole, thank you very much, Nicole. Put that on the screen for us. Now, another reason I wanted to interrupt Roger was so that I could get a word in edgewise.
Yeah, if you normally watch our show, you realize that that's an unusual experience for him.
Yes, it
yeah,
is.
Right.
So, I brought one book and four cameras, and I brilliantly did not bring the camera that I wanted to bring. Now, let's see here. And it's that one right there. Yes. The one on the little tripod. That is the one that was made here in North Adams.
Wow.
I grabbed the box for it, but I forgot to bring the camera.
What company made it, Paul?
I think it was Universal Cameras. But more on that next week when I bring the actual camera.
Okay.
So in the meantime, I brought an assortment of cameras. This one here is a stereo camera. Of course, what it does is it takes two pictures at once of the same thing, though of course they're not exactly the same thing. We tend to think that when we see things, we're only seeing one image, but that's not true. If you take your hand like this, and you hold it up in front of your eyes like this, close one eye and you will see the face of your hand. Open the other eye and you'll see the inner part of your hand and your thumb if it's in position. Now when you open both eyes, then you're seeing both sides of your hand. And that's because we're actually seeing two images. An easier way to do that is to cross your eyes.
Okay.
And if you can do it, cross them the other way. And what you get is a double image. Well, you're getting that double image all the time, but your brain takes those two images and compresses them into one.
Now, Paul, in this camera, when you take a photo, does he give you two images or just one?
It gives you two.
Huh.
When you advance the film, you have to advance it far enough so that you get another match set. These were originally, when these were originally made, you used slide film. Mm-hmm. And they would come back on a little card where they were properly arranged, so the one that matched your right eye was on the right side and the one that matched your left eye was on the other side, and you put it in a special viewer.
Almost like the ViewMaster that we used to
yeah.
use in grade school?
Yeah, exactly. And of course, that's an interesting explanation of how this works. If you remember them, they often use dioramas, mm-hmm. and they were three-dimensional. And that is because We see things in three dimensions. When I look at that camera there, I can see the edge of the table in front of me. I can see the floor. I can see the tripod and the camera, and I can see what's beyond it. I'm sorry, that camera. And I can see what's beyond it. But if you take a photograph with an ordinary camera, you get a flat image. But because this camera sees the world the way that you do, in fact, if we take a close look at this, sorry, Nicole, here we go. If you look at it this way, you'll find that these lenses match the position of your eyes.
Oh.
So it literally sees the world the way you do, and it takes two images that when you look at them together, you see things in three dimensions.
Okay. Now, does that use a regular film, or did you have to have
yes.
a special film?
No, no. The only thing wrong with this camera is it doesn't like to rewind. So I got some film for it, and I loaded it, and I shot the roll, and then I went to rewind it, and it kept getting stuck, and what I had to do was open it, cut the film, cut it, cut it, cut it. So, but it's still good as a collectible. Mm-hmm. I do have another stereo camera made by Kodak that I can actually use.
Wow. That's interesting.
Yes. Now, this camera that we were looking at earlier, this, of course, is a box camera. This is, it doesn't show up well there. I think I'll just put it here in front of me. This is a number zero Brownie box camera. It has two viewfinders, one here to take a vertical picture and one here to take a horizontal picture. And the shutter works both ways. So when I click the shutter that way, you can hear it clicking. Click it that way, you can take another picture. And of course, when you do that, if I had actually had film in here, it would be taking a double image, which looks great if you plan it that way. It looks terrible if you don't.
Right.
So then you advance the film, and you look in this little window here to see when the number is in the center, you've advanced the film properly, and you can take another picture. And then advance it again. However, it also has another little feature. When you pull up on this tab right here, the lens stays open until you physically close it. So if you want to take a long exposure of something, you'll have to put it on something so it's stable. Open that. Open the shutter. And then shut it when you're ready.
So that's more advanced than the old Brownies, right?
Well, yes and no. When Kodak first started making roll film, and I believe they were the first to use roll film, it came in a box camera that got 100 frames to a roll. And when you would shot the entire roll, then you sent them the camera. Oh. They opened it in the dark room, developed the film, loaded the camera with a fresh roll, and then sent it back to you with your pictures. Now, eventually, they got to the point where people wanted to develop their own film, perhaps, or be able to change the film when the camera, when the roll was used. So they came up with box cameras like this, and to change the film, well, of course, you advance it until the paper is completely wrapped around it. So it opens like this, and then this is the film that was in this camera when I got it. Oh. It's 127 film. So the other thing you do is you pull this out, and then this slides out. The this is the where you put the fresh film, and this is where the film gathers when you rotate it.
And how old is that camera for?
To tell the truth, I'm not sure. Let me take a look here.
I don't mean to put you on the spot, but it's, I know it's not, it's got to be fairly old.
U.S. patents, I think it's about 1903.
Wow.
Now, this is an unusual size, and I'm not sure that they make it anymore. I know Kodak doesn't. Well, actually, there's some... no, I'll wait until I bring in a 120 and a 620. This camera I was given, and this is the famous spy camera. You open it like this, you view it through through the viewfinder, and you fire the shutter like this, close it and open it again, and that advances the film. However, this camera, you can also adjust the shutter speed anywhere from a 25th of a second to a 50th. No, wait a second, that's not right. A 200th, a 50th, or a 25th of a second. You can also adjust the f-stop on this. And when the film was full, you opened it like this, and then it opened like this, and you could put in a new cartridge of film. This actually takes a cartridge.
Is that a Minolta?
Hmm?
Is that a Minolta?
No, it's Japanese.
Oh, okay.
Oh, yes, you're right, it is a Minolta. Minolta 16.
Interesting.
And then there is the monster.
Oh, yeah.
This is a Polaroid. And you open it.
I remember when those first came out.
Now, this is one of the earlier Bellows-type cameras. And when I put this in front of camera four, come on, there we go. This has this little tab that sticks out so you can stand it on a table. And it also has a viewfinder that opens out. And with this, you can focus. There's a little tab down here that focuses it from infinity to about 3.5 feet. And then you fire the shutter here. And then to get your film out, well, actually to get your picture out, This opens up, you pull the tab, and what happens in here, the film comes preloaded, and it's got the, if this is your negative, it's got, and this is the end that's coming out, there's a bubble along this edge, and that has all the chemicals in it. It goes between a pair of rollers, much like a mangle on an early washing machine, and the chemicals get spread over the image, or rather over the film, and when you pull it out, you wait a while, and then you peel the paper off, and there's your image. And I believe the very early ones, if you wanted to keep the image, you had to put some kind of, something like a lacquer on it.
Right, right. Very interesting.
Now, the thing about, you're going to be able to finish the show. Woo-ha!
I am.
Yes, you am.
With what?
With your book and your stories about being in the Navy. All together in the Navy, you can sail the seven seas in the Navy. Okay.
I will not sing.
So, something about Bellows cameras is that they're only good for so long, because the bellows is normally made of leather. And as leather ages, it dries out. And what often happens, what inevitably happens is that it develops light leaks. So it's no good as a camera anymore. It's good as a collectible. And it's a shame, because usually the cameras work as good as they ever did. I have a number of Bellows cameras that I can't use anymore, but if I could get 127 film for this little gem, I could still use it today, and I'd still get gorgeous pictures out of it.
Very interesting.
All right, so we have about 11 and a half minutes, so I want to remind our viewer.
Please.
Yeah.
Well, I know I got one viewer.
Okay.
I know that for sure.
Okay, so I want to remind both of our viewers that if you have something you want us to talk about or something you want us to read, please send us a message at historyman@copper.net. And just in case we forget at the end of the show, I do want to thank Nicole for directing. She's doing a terrific job, as she always does.
Absolutely.
With everything she does.
Thank you, Nicole.
And feel free to answer us through the loudspeaker.
Thank you, guys.
You're welcome, dear. Okay, so, Roger, we now have 10 and a half minutes.
Well, I have another sea story for you. When an aircraft carrier is going through what they call flight ops, that is, the aircraft are flying off and landing, we always had a destroyer, a smaller ship, follow us. And they were about, half a mile behind us, or sometimes even a little bit closer. And the reason for that is this: somebody made a boo-boo and ended up going into the water. That was what they call a plane guard. And they would come by and they'd try to pick up either the person or what was left of the person. And I say that in all honesty.
I believe it.
But when we were in the Mediterranean, we used to have this Russian destroyer, and somewhere in my collection, I've got a picture of it, I believe. And they would assume the position of our plane guard, which really made our skipper mad. He was very angry because that interfered with our flight operations. I mean, the destroyer that was behind him was ours, and he would have to come around, and, you know, the seamanship there was a little tricky. So Night after night, this guy would come right behind us and follow us where we were having night ops, or night operations. He got angry one night and ordered one of our aircraft, an RA-5C. Now, that doesn't mean anything to anybody except somebody that knows what that plane is. But it was a large jet photo recon aircraft. And they could fly over an area and take, you know, all kinds of pictures of whatever they wanted to take pictures of.
But and they also had strobes on them, didn't they?
Yes, that's just about what I was going to say. We also had two wing-mounted lights. One was a strobe, or they could make it become a strobe, and the other was a solid beam. And the pilot or whoever was doing that could control it. I never got in one of those things, so I have no idea. But he ordered that plane up, and we didn't know why, because that plane usually didn't fly around at night. Well, he had this guy, and by the way, this airplane was supersonic. It was fast. He ordered him to take off and go off for about 15, 20 minutes to who knows where, and came back over the Russian, maybe a little bit above mast height, which means he was probably about 200 feet. Hit the strobe light and go supersonic at the same time. So what happened was you get this loud flash and a boom. Well, that tells you you're under attack. And needless to say, the Russian destroyer left us, and we didn't see it again for about another 4 or 5 weeks. So Captain Tully did a great job with that one. He probably thought an A-bomb was going off. You know, that was a brilliant idea. I don't know where he came up with that one. But he was quite a guy.
Actually, I have a question for you.
Sure.
Considering the size of a modern aircraft carrier and how long their runway actually is, if you were flying, say, a biplane, could you land on the deck, and for that matter, take off from the deck without using the lines?
Sure. Matter of fact, when you go through your flight training, you do what they call touch and goes. Wheels touch and you go full power and take off again. And it's not unusual. I mean, it's routine. If you miss all the wires, you don't make anybody very happy if you were supposed to come to a full trap landing, you know, full stop. But touch and goes were routine, absolutely. Yeah.
Yeah, but I mean, could you land the biplane on the deck without hooking onto the wires? And you could come to a full stop
if you had good brakes. But you know, they didn't do that. Try not to do that. The planes that we flew, you couldn't do it because you come in at a pretty good clip. And you go from whatever landing speed you're coming at, once you hit the wire and trap the wire, you go from that speed to zero in just a few seconds. So it's quite an experience. That's why the passengers that fly in on the cod seat with their back to the front of the aircraft, because they don't feel that massive jolt, you know? But no, touch and go is something you have to learn when you're a student flyer. Yeah.
So, do you have anything else from the book?
Not a great deal. You can see I've got it pretty well bookmarked here.
Yeah.
Let's see if I can find something that I thought was of interest. Pilot's description of landing on an aircraft carrier was like trying to land on a postage stamp, and one of the guys I met later on the carrier would use exactly that phrase, which takes some doing, of course, But if it's daylight, with a steady wind, perfect visibility, and the sea is flat and calm, it looks fairly routine. But then you throw in some variables, such as a storm, crosswinds, rain, pitching seas, so that looking through the plexiglass of the cockpit is like being on a trawler in the North Sea, or maybe one engine's gone, or both engines are gone, or you're blinded by gunfire, unable to see anything, taking instructions from a plane on your wing, and the LSO, nobody raising their voices. At one point they do, but you hear right rudder, and then if you hear attitude, attitude, and the LSO, landing signals officer on the ship, is talking to you, and that means you got to adjust your attitude. Not your personal attitude, but the aircraft's attitude.
Yes, I understand.
And if you hear power, 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 that means that you're really screwing up. You've got to add power immediately so that you're actually coming over the flight deck and not into the stern of the ship. Okay? Then you can you might hear, if you really screw up, eject, 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 which is interesting. Now, the plane I flew, you didn't eject. It was an old airplane.
Yes, you stood on the, you took the seatbelt off, you stood on the seat, you pulled the canopy back.
Well, you didn't have to pull it back. It was, it would fly back, but it wasn't like they have now where they eject it. No. Yeah, and you make a very unhappy person. You, the LSO, and then the captain when he gets a hold of you. You're graded on every Navy pilot is graded on every landing he makes, every one. So that your training really comes into effect to make sure that you're doing everything properly. There are, if I remember right, there are five wires stretched across the deck. The optimum wire to catch is number three. That means you've come in at the perfect angle. Perfect airspeed, perfect angle. Now, on the aircraft carriers, even when I was on, the deck is what they call an angle deck. The old aircraft carriers of World War II and a little bit beyond that, even Korea, were a straight flight deck from the back, the stern, to the bow, the front. The new ones, you come in at an angle. And there's an angle deck, and the wires are stretched across that way, so that when you land, you're not facing the bow, you're facing just a few degrees off. So that if you have to bolt, then you're taking off without any aircraft being in front of you on the deck. So it's a tricky situation. Navy fighters brag that they're the best trained in the world. I believe it.
Absolutely.
When you think of, outside of the norm flying that you have to do, to landing on something that's moving, and not only moving in a straight line, but maybe doing this at the same time, that is rocking back and forth, so that you have to match that, it can be tricky.
Yeah.
Never had to have that experience.
We have 25 seconds left. So thank you, Roger.
My pleasure.
That was wonderful. And I hope my cameras were wonderful, too. Next week, I will definitely bring back that one. Yeah, the one I was just pointing at a moment ago that I actually figured out how to do. Thank you for joining us. We'll see you next week. Thank you, Nicole. You're wonderful.
I'm happy.